get ready to see something that's going to make you remember it for the rest of your lives. Well, welcome back to the Sharon Moore Show. Of course, you know, I'm Sharon Moore, your host. Today, a segment I call Extraordinary Drummers. And today, as you can see, I got the man with me. Don't get no bigger than this, okay? If I had to read his credits to you, to read like who's who, to read like going into a record store back in the day and just going through all of the albums, and I'm sure he's worked with them. Let me tell you some of the credits. Of course, Michael Jackson, Madonna, Elton John, Diana Ross, the Eagles, Janet Jackson, Stevie Wonder. I mean, really, you know what I mean? Will you help me welcome, please, the amazing, the extraordinary drummer, the legend, Sugarfoot, Jonathan Moffatt. Jonathan Sugarfoot Moffatt, right here. Hey, brother.
Hey, my friend. How you doing?
Hey, man.
Good to reunion like this. appreciate you for having me.
I had to say the name Sugarfoot twice. Hey, man, thanks for being on our show, man.
It's a pleasure of mine. Thanks for having me.
I really do appreciate it. I know your schedule is just packed solid. You're very, very, very busy.
I've been blessed. You know, my manager upstairs, God, my manager, Jesus Christ, my agent. The key keeps me busy. I've been blessed in that fact. Trying to keep it going. I still feel a lot of life in me, and my career is just going to the second phase, and I'm ready for it. I got a lot of things, great things ahead.
You know, speaking of being blessed, one of my first questions to you, Jonathan, you ever pinch yourself and just say, what a ride, what a journey?
Well, I don't pinch myself because that hurts. So I don't pinch myself. I look back quite often. And then I read my resume, and then I realize it can't all be me. You know, I'm a human being, you know. It has to be the creator, it has to be a guide, because I have no earthly manager. I've never had, in 39 years of professionalism, had an earthly manager or earthly agent. Everything just came to me, in a sense, but it was sent to me. And I think, and I attribute it to my heavenly manager, my heavenly agent, God and Jesus Christ, because how could that list of artists and body of work read as it does otherwise? It wasn't that I was going out hustling and auditioning and trying to make things happen. I never ever once did that. The phone would ring and it would be there. And then I would go and play, you know, and I've only had to audition 3 or 4 times in 39 years. And so everything else was there for me. And I've been truly, truly blessed. I don't take it for granted. I'm the little boy who picked up 2 sticks when he was 6 years old and started whacking on things. And they say, this is fun. I think I want to do this the rest of my life. So here I am, most of my life, you know, trying to do this the rest of my life. I'm 63, I'll be 64 in a couple months, and I'm still loving it like I was a 6-year-old boy.
Wow. Where'd you get the name Sugarfoot? Someone said Michael gave you that name.
No, Michael calls me Foot for sure. Sugarfoot came from a local band in New Orleans. The leader of the band was named Curtis Verrett. And it was the second band I was with, the first band being my brother's band. And this second band heard me with my brother's band. And when I was about 12 years old, I joined this band unwillingly in a way, because my brothers didn't let me go because they wanted to play certain nightclubs that wouldn't let me be being underage in the club. Mm-hmm. So some did, some didn't. But then when they let me go, I was so disheartened and everything. And then I got a knock on my mother's door from Curtis Verrett, the leader of the band called The Brotherhood. And he asked me to join the band.
Who were some of your influences coming up? I read Buddy Rich, Billy Cobham.
Yeah, like most drummers, you got to include Buddy Rich. I mean, that's right. An absolute must.
Yes.
And he's got to be number one, because he's still the most phenomenal drummer I've ever heard. And then you have to say Louis Belson. You have to say Gene Krupa was great. But I started, of course, listening to the more R&B, funk, and pop music. But in the 60s, more R&B rock and funk. And then I started getting into the James Brown drummers were unbelievable and still are. You listen to their stuff, they played, it was like to the future of drumming. The rhythms that Clyde and J-Bo and Melvin played for James were just unmatched to anybody else. The rhythms they created and invented the style.
Jonathan, this next topic I want to talk about is drum techniques. Talk about drums a little bit. Where did you come up with that theme, which seems like a kung fu theme? Like, is that what it is?
It's inspired off of kung fu. I was a big fan of Bruce Lee.
Oh,
like a lot of people are at that era. We love Bruce Lee. He had skills that was unmatched and unbelievable. His discipline, and he is quick of hand. And his movements and his motions. And so I was inspired by some of his movements and his movies. Enter the Dragon was unbelievable. And other films that he had done. And I tried to get that movement of art. Not so much the catching of the cymbals, that happened in a natural way. But when he does it, it's like ballet. You know, when you watch the martial artists do their thing, it's like ballet, their arm movements, and it's like artistic, and it shows. And you can see it. You can see it in their performance and their filming. So I wanted to have that kind of flow. That's why I put my cymbals up high, so I can have movement and space to throw my hands and do things. And I've gotten the notion of putting cymbals behind my back, because I was a very avid fan of Marvel Comics. And I wanted to be like superhero powers. And I said one day, practicing, I said, I had powers like superhero Marvel characters. I said, if I wasn't as a drummer, what kind of powers could I have, or would I have? And I say, what if I could hit something behind my back, like eyes behind your head, and you can see, like without looking at it, as if you could see it. So I move my cymbals to the back, behind me, pretty far behind me, and I said, let me try and see if I can do that, and make it work. So I put them behind me, and then I got used to hitting them, crash, there's a certain arm movement and flex, and knowing where the cymbals are, you hit it, and it just rings out, okay? So I started soloing at my home, practicing, and I said, let me hit a crash in front of me, I'm gonna hit it behind me. So I did my solo and my times and everything, and I went to hit the cymbal behind me, and as I'm in mid-motion, I said, no, I don't want that cymbal. And I stopped the cymbal with my hand, because I changed my mind about hitting that cymbal back then, having that tone of cymbal. They didn't stop it and said, oh, that was kind of cool sounding. I catch that cutoff sound. I said, this is kind of cool. So I start working with it and then start catching it, making sure it's in the right position so I won't cut my hand. Got that pretty fluent. I said, let me try my left hand, because I'm right-handed. And a lot of times right-handed, your left hand is a little different. You know, you got to work it up more. So I put it by my left side. I start working on that side. Then I got fluent at both. And so I'm doing a double clutch in. I call it the backlash whiplash. So I do that one, I do that one, I do that one, I cross over, bam, bam. You know, I do pow like that. And it became a thing, you know, a vocabulary in my playing, because the soundings of the cymbals, as they ring out or as I catch them, it becomes, I can make phrases, I can make melodies, because each one has a different pitch.
And as you was going on making a name for yourself, one of the songs I didn't know you played on was Don't Stop the Music with Y'all Burling People.
Exactly.
Yeah. Don't you stop the music. You don't really want to stop. You actually played drums on that, huh?
That was the first recording
that
released in the big scale of my career after I moved out here. Recorded that in 1980 for Total Experience Records with Y'all Burling People. and Lonnie Simmons, the owner of Total Experience.
Yeah.
And I did that whole album, Don't Stop album, and I did most of the second album.
Tell me about endorsements. Well, I know you're using the DW drum kit. What are your other endorsement products that you're using up there on the riser?
I'm using the great microphone company, Earthworks Microphones. They're awesome. If you ever watched the Drumeo videos that I've done recently, and back in April and released in May, those drum sounds come from my Earthworks microphones. And Drumeo has their set, that's their set, but I have my own set. And they're really remarkably creative. They're like Rolls Royce tools of the trade, the quality. But the sonic quality is equally as impressive as you can hear on the videos. All you have to do is listen to the videos, and a lot of comments are coming in as to the drum sounds. But the drums sound how they sound, but the drums need a translator. And the microphones in your drum set is the translator for your sound. So Earthworks microphones are pretty remarkable in both their makeup and their sonic qualities. They give me the tones and the projection and translation of my playing that I need and want to have. So I'm with Earthworks microphones. I'm with Remo Drumheads. I've been with Remo since 1981, the Triumph Tour with the Jacksons. So I've been with them a long, long time. And I'm with QSC, Monitor Systems. You know, they're remarkable monitor systems. Give me the beat in the body that pushes sound, that makes me excited, my spirit wants me to play harder and stronger. I love the clarity of the QSC stuff. So I've been with them. And there's some other endorsements I have, the Rim Risers. And right now I'm looking at some other new products too.
You're currently playing with Cameo.
Yeah.
Blackman?
Blackman, yes.
Blackman, how's that?
It's fantastic.
That's some cold-blooded 2 and 4, boy.
He reinvented funk, and I'm currently doing it, but I'm only continuing my 36-year association and alumni with Cameo, which I'm very, very proud of.
Wow.
Because Larry is one of the most innovative drummers, especially in the funk and R&B market.
Television appearances. You've been on everything. That's what I wrote here. I wrote everything. But I saw you on one a few years back. You was on the A-Team. Do you remember that?
You got that. You found that.
Yeah, you was with Isaac Hayes. Tell me about that. That was sweet, man.
Yeah, I got that thing. I was on one of the episodes of the very, very popular show, A-Team. Most of you people my age, of course, will know it. But I got on there through an agency that booked me and some other musicians to be banned for the scene in that particular episode of the A-Team with Isaac Hayes and Rick James. And Isaac was incarcerated in jail, and Rick James was kind of come up do a benefit concert for him. So we was on stage filming that as if Isaac occasionally would do concerts for the inmates. And then of course, if you saw the series, a fight breaks out at the concert. and everybody jumps up and start running. They told me to run as fast as you can, get off the drum set. So of course I try to make it comical and make it funny. So I did it a certain way. You have to see it, but it was fun to do. And we shot that at a prison out near Magic Mountain in California. And a real prison with real inmates. Those were real inmates. They were so nice and so cool, man.
Jonathan, you've won many awards, plaques, platinum awards. Is there one that stands out? Is there one that means a little more to you than the others, or than others perhaps?
Let me see. Yes, there's been quite a few of them that have been awarded by the artists that I work with for the tours that I do, promoting the records and making them go platinum and double platinum and triple and so on. Yeah, but the ones that I got from MJ, of course, because those albums made history, you know, in the industry, and they set records. I would have to say those are the ones that mean a lot to me, because Michael set a new precedence at album sales. And present us with the plaques, they tell us this is for your contribution in helping it become multi-platinum like that by the tours promoting the record. Jonathan, let's talk about your dance partner. You did not do that. I heard you call him your dance partner. And I'm going to try to see if I can figure this out. You once said, and I can almost quote, but you once said, people were dancing to your beat and they were fascinated and enjoying Michael, but it was the beat that was explain how you said that. Well, being the kind of drummer that I am, I play off the artist. I listen to his words that he's singing and his timing. I hit accents and stuff like that. But an artist like Madonna and artists like Michael Jackson, and especially Michael, who's known for his incredible creative spontaneity of dance, I felt like I had to be his inspiration. I had to put more soul into the beat that was there on the record. I had to put more human experience and emotion, and that he can feel that, to transmit it to him, that it would inspire his spirit and bring forth some capabilities and abilities and creativity when he dances more than he's done before the show before. So I would play at the end of Billie Jean is a segment when Michael and I become dance partners. And it's just he and I. Everybody else is in the dark behind the stage. It's just he and I. And I know I have to motivate him, because this is his moment of all the moments in the show where everybody waits for, and his most creative dance moment. So I play even stronger, even though I play very, very strong when I'm playing any of the songs. I play, dig up more power and hit more definitive, more articulate, and more emotionally to try to drive his spirit and let him feel it. And then I start seeing his shoulders move more aggressively, and his feet start moving and doing patterns that he hadn't done before. I can feel it, and he'll do it longer and longer each time. And because at that moment, the Billie Jean, especially of all the songs in the show, at that moment, it's just he and I. We like dance partners on that part of the show, just one-on-one. And it's my beat that motivates his feet.
Wow.
And his spirit and his soul to give you the creativity that the people are so, so excited about when they see him or witness him doing the dance to Billie Jean at the end of the movie.
Jonathan, I noticed on the Victory Tour with the Jacksons and Michael Jackson, all those tempos was hot. All those tempos was like double time.
Yes, they were.
Did you catch that?
Of course I did.
Man, did that cost your stamina? Or why was that because of the energy?
No, that's how the tempos that Michael and Jackie felt they should be, because they were into this thing like the James Brown days and like the old school 60 days and Otis Redding. On a live show, they stepped the tempos up way high, way faster, pace of the show. Because like Jackie's would always say, when I try to slow him down at rehearsals, say, no, put, this is live. Even Michael said that, no, put, it's live. It's gotta be up there. I said, but we don't have time for the groove. There's no space because the notes are crunched together. There's no room to put emotion. I mean, I had to do it, you could put it, but if it was slow, I could put even more emotion and attitude on it. But they felt from their teachings with Motown that it had to be up the tempo. So that's what we wound up with on the Victory Tour. And on the Triumph Tour, a lot of times, it was the tempos were so fast. And but we still made it feel good, you know. But I was always trying to press to pull them back a little bit so we can get more space between the notes and add more attitude and feelings and spirit. And you know, so, but that's the way they wanted. They had that kind of energy. Fortunate for me, I grew up learning James Brown like stuff at home, and a lot of his live show stuff where the tempos were up.
Yeah.
And I just naturally, for some reason, since a young boy, had extra energy. So it was no sweat for me to play. I played even twice as fast as we did, and I'd be tired. That's just an element of my chemistry. But I'm more interested in the feel that relates to the song. And so I was trying to attain that, but of course I'm there to please my artists. So I had to play where they wanted. But those tempos were hot.
they were stupid.
Yes.
I'm surprised that show wasn't 15 minutes with those tempos.
But it might have been okay. It turned out well. Yeah.
Tell me about, let me know if we're able to talk about this. The master, Michael not being with us anymore. I'm sure after spending practically all of his life with him, that must have really touched you that day. Are we able to talk about that?
Yeah, we can talk about that, yeah. Of course, there's a hole in my heart where he used to reside. He's still there in love, but knowing that he's not with me in the physicality, there's a hole there. But he always have a room in my heart, a private room. And it really devastated me when I got the word, I literally went in shock. They tried to call the paramedics, and I went into a shock that I never experienced. Different physically, mentally, emotionally. I broke down. The worst I've ever done. Difficult because I just hugged him the night before, 2 hours before, and he said, "I love you, Foot. I'll see you tomorrow. This is gonna be great. I can't wait to tomorrow." I said, "I love you too, Mike. I can't wait either." That was only like at 1:30 in the morning after we finished rehearsals late, and then the next morning he was gone. And they pronounced him at 2 something. He was gone around the morning sometime. So. It's the unthinkable when the perceived invincible is gone, effectively. You lose the person that you thought was invincible, like his alpine stage. We all thought of him bigger than life, magnitude on a scale like nobody else, you know? And he was still relatively young. So to hear that something that happened, and I just touched him in the living, hugged him in the living. And spoke with him, exchange love for one another in the living, and know that I'll never hear his voice again. I never begin to speak with him, say I love you, and he can't tell me he loved me. No, I can't play Billie Jean ever again that way. back error is gone. I play these tracks that I have, but he's not. I look for him and I play him, and it's not there. So there's an element of missing and looking the tracks and the sense of the show that I do now. I do remember the time when Michael Jackson show of my own, and I play it just like he's there. But the inner spirit knows he's, you can't see him on stage. So I have to just keep my mind focused on executing as if he's there. It's been a very difficult thing to accept. Difficult to know that 9 years have gone by already so quickly, unbelievable.
Yes.
And it's almost like we're still expecting to be here. But I know he's in a better place and not hurting anymore.
Let me close us up. We do a segment at the end of the show where we ask the drummers if they would leave the younger guys coming up, the guys out there frustrated and trying to get traction in their career and their playing. Would you leave a word of advice for some of those guys that's coming up out there? You can look right in the camera tonight.
There's no end to what's possible unless you end it yourself. You are the cutoff switch. As long as you believe in yourself, as long as you develop your talent, your gifts to a place that you know people will appreciate it, you must push forward. You must always strive to practice and get better. You must put yourself in an element and scene in an area that you can be seen and heard. I had to move from New Orleans to come here to Hollywood. Otherwise, nobody would have known about me what I had to do. You must follow the path of success. Do not give up on yourself, because if you give up on yourself, nobody else will believe in you. Now, you're your best promoter. You're your best agent, and you're within yourself, other than God himself. You have to believe that there's something for you, which I did when I drove 3,000 something miles on my own to come out here and give myself the chance, because I believed it was for me, meant for me. I really saw it. It was real in my heart, my mind, and my spirit back in New Orleans. And it was worth the journey of 3,000 something miles driving on the road all the way here, out here to give myself a chance. You need a chance. You can't stop believing in yourself. Carry forth, practice, be the best you can be, and give yourself an opportunity.
Thank you, brother.
It's a pleasure of mine. Thank you so much, man, for having me. I enjoyed it. It was a good experience, great environment, and
yes.
Thank you for coming out and
yes.
doing this interview.
I appreciate it, man.
Fantastic.
This is
fantastic.
Definitely a milestone, a highlight in my career as a show, but in my life.
Wow.
You've been, I don't want to get saucy and mushy here, but like for so many people, you have been a blessing in my life. You set the bar at a place where we just was like, really, Jonathan? Really? If we get half of that drum set, we do it okay? And we just really love you, man. We appreciate you. You're an icon, you're a legend, your body of work, but the person. And then to hear all underneath all of that, your agent, your manager, dad upstairs.
The love is reciprocal, and you know, I'm just trying to share my life with people now that I'm being able to come to the level that I can, have the broad stage of the world to do so, and show everybody what God has given me. So I'm loving it, I'm still having fun at it, and I'm just getting going on chapter 2, which is about me.
Yes, sir.
So there's a lot more to come. Stay tuned.
We
brace yourselves.
Absolutely. Thank you, brother.
You're very, very welcome.
That's
it's a wonderful experience.
Would you help us say goodbye? Give the guys a little wave for us.
Much love to you all. Love life. Life loves you.
Here on Extraordinary Drummers. Thank you. Bye now.